With the end of hostilities at the end of 1918, the following spring, the victors now had the long and tedious task of preparing and formalizing the peace treaty that would officially end the Great War. There were to be many events and decisions to be made that were going to affect the entire world, even those who were barely involved. A large number of nations sent delegates and representatives to France in order to plead their cases and to hopefully receive gains or reparations for their losses in the war. Most nations were welcome, with the exception of the newly founded Soviet Union, which the West did not even recognize as the official government of Russia, which was in the midst of the Russian Civil War, with British, American, and Japanese troops backing the Provisional Government, or White Russians, against the Bolsheviks, of which Winston Churchill would go on to later say in 1949, "If I had been properly supported in 1919, I think we might have strangled Bolshevism in its cradle," and everybody turned up their hands and said, "How shocking," close quote. Another factor was due to when the communists came to power through the Bolshevik Revolution of 1917, one of the first official acts of his new leader, Vladimir Lenin, was to send Leon Trotsky to negotiate peace terms with the Germans, which broke the promise of the Russian Provisional Government that they would continue to pursue the war until its end. Another reason for hostility toward the new nation was that Lenin also chose to default on Russia's loans from the West, leaving millions of French francs and British pounds unrepaid. The main leaders of the proceedings were known as the Big Four: David Lloyd George of Britain, Georges Clemenceau of France, Woodrow Wilson of the United States, and Vittorio Orlando of Italy. For the American president, Woodrow Wilson, it would be the first time a standing U.S. president would travel to Europe, his name now being lauded by much of the world for his 14-point speech, which, in general terms, spoke of fairness and equality in making the peace, which Germany now put its hopes into that they might receive fair terms at Versailles. What was also of the utmost importance to Wilson was the forming of the League of Nations, which was meant to prevent such a war from happening again. There was also a young, disillusioned French colonist, coincidentally, in Paris, and also having learned of Wilson's 14 points, was hopeful to obtain at least a portion of what Wilson spoke of for his nation of French Indochina. He attempted to arrange a meeting with President Wilson through the Secretary of State to hopefully discuss the matter, yet Wilson would not set the meeting, and the young man was sent away. This event and those that came of Versailles would come to greatly affect the nation of the young man, who would eventually change his name to Ho Chi Minh. One of the points that would be dictated to Eastern European nations was that they were to respect the rights, cultures, and religious beliefs of their minorities. Present also at the conference was Romanian Queen Marie, born of British and Russian nobility. She was also first cousins with King George V, Kaiser Wilhelm, and the late Tsar Nicholas II, as she being a granddaughter of Queen Victoria. Upon learning the demands of the treatment of minorities, Queen Marie shot back with, "What about similar provisions for the blacks in the United States or the Irish in Britain?" calling out the hypocrisy of the West and that they were not required to sign the treaty. In the coming months, the Big Four would treat all three members of the defeated Central Powers in completely different ways. The Ottoman Empire was to be carved up and divided between the British and French empires, placing official borders in a part of the world that had never known them to that point, the result being the formation of most of the Middle Eastern nations we know today. The Austro-Hungarian Empire was to be dismantled as well, yet each nation would command its own sovereignty, with the southern portion of the former country being formed out of Serbia, Croatia, Montenegro, Kosovo, Slovenia, Bosnia, and Macedonia. This new country would initially be given the name of the Kingdom of Serbs, Croats, and Slovenes, and would formally have its name changed to Yugoslavia, which means South Slavs, in 1929. Of the former Austria-Hungary, Austria would be the only defeated nation to actually gain territory when the West was finished redoing Europe's eastern borders. The Ottoman Turks and Austro-Hungarian representatives were treated with a level of respect, all the while the West, France and Britain in particular, had entirely different ideas of how the peace would be for Germany.